Hello, lecturer from SBB College of Physiotherapy, welcome you all to the UG paper presentation session on celebrating the Foundation Day of IAP Women's Health. This event also comprised of various cultural activities like dance, singing, etc., along with paper and poster presentations by the senior faculties, clinical therapists, academicians, postgraduate and undergraduate students. I thank Dr. Sanjeev Jha sir, Dr. Ruchi Varshney madam, Dr. Nehal Shah madam, and others at IAP and IAPWC to give me this privilege to be the moderator for today's session. I request Dr. Uthra madam to please play the video.
All physiotherapists, physiotherapy students, and all the persons who are directly or indirectly related with physiotherapy profession. On behalf of IAP, I wish everybody a very, very prosperous and celebrating fruitful World Physiotherapy Day. On this day, we celebrate this from the side of World Physiotherapy and from the side of President World Physiotherapy Emma Stoke and my all EC, we invite you to celebrate this day to mark your presence of physiotherapy profession all over India. And I wish that all the programs, seminars, conferences, workshops, camps, and everything organized on this auspicious of physiotherapy week by various colleges, member colleges, by various institutes, by IAP, by Women's Health, by IAP state branches, will be a milestone, and it will prove and it will reach to the common people and to each and everyone in our society. I can tell you that physiotherapy is the need of our, and physiotherapy is the need of society. And now, after we have received a recognition from Government of India in the form of Physiotherapy Bill, in Allied Health and Healthcare Council Bill, let me assure you, now physiotherapy is an independent profession, and now let's move with a different attitude, different professionalism, and with all wholehearted zeal to take this physiotherapy profession to each and every needy patient and individual in our society and nation. Again, wishing you a very happy World Physiotherapy Day. Thank you.
I take this privilege to describe the judges for today's session. The judges for today's session are Dr. R. Arunachalam sir and Dr. Supreet Bindra madam. Dr. R. Arunachalam sir is a professor and principal at College of Physiotherapy at Madhav University, Abu Road, Rajasthan. He is also an in charge for guiding the PhD scholars at Madhav University. He has been international guide for PhD and M philosophy programs at General Sir John Kotelawala Defense University, Sri Lanka. He accomplished his PhD from Savitha University, Chennai in July 2017. To add to his qualifications, he has also been done the MSc course in Yoga and Naturopathy from Tamil Nadu, Doctorate in Acupuncture from Sri Lanka, PG DIP Diabetic Education from Christian Medical College, Vellore, Certified Medical Content Writer from Henry Harvin University. He has 14 years of postgraduate teaching experience, and his special interests are in stroke rehabilitation, trunk rehabilitation, yoga and diabetic education, potential empowerment. He has over more than 80 publications in national and international journals. We welcome you, sir. Our second judge for today is Dr. Supreet Bindra madam. She is a Master's of Physiotherapy in Musculoskeletal Condition from Punjab University, Patiala, and also a PhD with Grade A passed out from Patiala. At present, she is an assistant professor at Department of Physiotherapy, Sri Guru Granth Sahib World University. She has also worked as an in-charge of physiotherapy department at ESIC Model Hospital, Ludhiana for over 6 years. She is a gold medalist in both her undergraduate and postgraduate studies. She has chaired various sessions of national and international levels. To add to her credits, she has 20 publications in national and international journals, has authored chapters in 15 books, has been a resource person in 16 lectures or CMEs, presented 18 papers, participated in more than 28 camps, has been a panelist, have received appreciations, has attended various workshops and conferences, and the list is endless. On behalf of IAP and IAP Women's Cell, I welcome both the judges for today's session. A brief instruction for all the participants for today. Each participant will be given 5 minutes time to present their paper, which will be followed by 2 minutes of question and answer session. At no point of time, the participant is supposed to reveal their identity. Thank you so much. And now we can begin the session with the first candidate. The scoring sheet is already been given to both the judges. So I request both the judges to look at the scoring sheet and the marks to be given according to the scoring sheet. The results will not be declared today and will be declared tomorrow on IAP Day. Is UG01 ready?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. You can start now.
Yes, ma'am. It is visible or not, ma'am?
Yes, it is visible. You will have to do full screen.
Yes, ma'am. Wait a sec, ma'am. Good morning, sir and ma'am. Title of my project is Association Between Duration and Symptoms of Diabetic Neuropathy in a Diabetic Neuropathy Patient. My research question is there any association between duration and symptoms in diabetic neuropathy patients? Introduction. As a diabetic neuropathy is one of the most common complications of the diabetes mellitus, it is also called as a nerve injury, which is associated with the duration and the HbA1c levels of the diabetes. The distal peripheral neuropathy is a most common type in which nerves of the legs and feet are more commonly involved. As we can see that the global prevalence of the diabetic neuropathy is 8.8% among the adults, and number will be expected to rise as the 10.4% by the 2040. So the overall prevalence of the diabetic neuropathy was 39.3% in a rural southern India. And also, the prevalence of the diabetic neuropathy among the diabetes in the Ahmednagar city by using the MNSI was found to be 6.25% for the pure neuropathy and is 42.70% for the patients with the only significant clinical examination. So as per the given information by the free article, the total duration of the diabetic neuropathy was 9 years since the diagnosis of the diabetes. The duration of the diabetic neuropathy varies from months to years. It is well-known fact that the average time gap between the onset of the diabetes and its detection in the individual is the 4 to 7 years. So the need of the study is that in some diabetic patients, after a certain duration, there is a development of the diabetic neuropathy. But it is not necessary that all the diabetic patients shows the signs and symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy after a certain duration. And therefore, to find out the association of the duration and symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy, we need to study on this topic, as the aim is to assess the relationship between the duration and the symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy. We are doing this study, and objective of my study is to find out the relationship between duration and symptoms in the diabetic neuropathy patient. So the hypothesis, that is alternative hypothesis and the null hypothesis, in which alternative hypothesis is that there is any relationship between the duration and symptoms in the diabetic neuropathy in neuropathy patient, and null hypothesis that there is no relationship or no any relationship between duration and symptoms. Now, methodology is study design is, it is population-based cross-sectional study. Study setting is a Vikhe Patil Memorial Hospital neurophysiotherapy OPD. Sampling technique which I used is a purposive sampling technique, and sample size is 32 patients, and study duration is 6 months. So I included my patients included in my study are the age between the 25 and 70 years old. Both males and females were included, and the patients which are diagnosed as a diabetes and diabetic neuropathy patients according to the Michigan Neuropathy Screening Instrument Scale and the HbA1c test. And the excluded patients are like the asymptomatic diabetic patients, patients with the severe neurological, musculoskeletal or the cardiac problems such as a stroke, osteoarthritis, polyneuropathy or multiple sclerosis, and many. Patients having a poor mental status are also excluded from my study. The procedure done was the ethical committee approval was taken. The patients who are willing to participate are taken in my study, that consent form was filled by the patient, and the screening of the patients is done as per the inclusion and exclusion criteria. Then orientation was given to the patients, that is what is my purpose, procedure and benefits of my study to the patient. Then data collection sheet was filled by patients, and ANSS scale was performed on the patients in a clinical setup, and the result is analyzed by the statistical test. So the variables are the my independent variables of the study are the age and gender, and dependent variables are like duration of the diabetic neuropathy and symptoms of neuropathy.
Statistical
test performed is a Pearson correlation. Consent form is taken from the patient. As the outcome measure is the ANSI, that is Ahmednagar Neuropathy Screening Instrument Scale. So my master chart is, ma'am, 1 minute. Please give me 1 minute. I'm going to show the result. So the this is a result which I performed Ahmednagar Neuropathy Screening Instrument Scale on the patients. And the result is that the as the symptoms appears in the patients, physically appearance of the symptoms is appears according to the duration. That is, more the duration, then the symptoms will appear on the patient. Then linear correlation, as the number of points is 31, correlation coefficient is given, and as the total p-value is 0.015, considered very significant, which shows that there is a relationship between the duration and symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy patient. Ahmednagar Neuropathy Screening Instrument Scale involved the 5 components, that is the muscle strength, then symptoms, appearance of the feet, reflexes, and the sensations which we are going to perform on the patient. And the muscle strength is graded accordingly, that is 0, 1, and 2. Reflexes are also graded as normal, diminished, or absent. Then sensations like temperature, touch, pinprick, vibration, and joint sensation. So total score of the Ahmednagar Neuropathy Screening Instrument is 68. So the more the score, then more the severity of the diabetic neuropathy, that is the more duration of the diabetic neuropathy is seen in the patients, and symptoms are seen accordingly. So my project reveals that there is a relationship between the duration and symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy. And the limitation, the major limiting factor during the study was the COVID-19 situation, as the Ahmednagar Neuropathy Screening Instrument Scale is taken on the patients in a clinical setup. So due to COVID-19, I was unable to take more samples from the clinical setups, and this was the major limiting factor during the study. ma'am, I'm going to show my Excel sheet. That is my master chart. So these five components, that is muscle strength, reflexes, sensation, symptoms, and appearance of the feet is analyzed, and the total score is accordingly. Out of the 68, how much is patient scores on the Ahmednagar neuropathy screening instrument? So accordingly, we calculate that the more the score, more the severity of the diabetic neuropathy. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, UG01. I request judges to please go for question answer round.
It was a very good presentation. First of all, I'm so happy that there was a cross-section study coming up. I believe in undergraduate doing less complicated research than very complicated research, which is not practically feasible. I also appreciate the topic of selection. Can I have the title, please? Title page.
Hello.
Can you please display the title of this research?
Sir, you are not audible, sir.
Sir is asking about the title of the study. Can you please show the title of the study?
Yes, ma'am. Sir, my title of the study is Association Between Duration and Symptoms of Diabetic Neuropathy in a Diabetic Neuropathy Patients Only.
Okay. So, always when you go for a title, make sure that you mention the study methodology in that. So, this if you have added a cross-section study, that would have... Everyone understand that it's a cross-section study. Okay. So, my congratulations and appreciation for this presentation. Next is, in the inclusion criteria, you had mentioned about HbA1c. So how much was the HbA1c you had included?
Sir, normal HbA1c range is, that is 4 to 5.5. So I included the patients who are scoring the HbA1c more than 6.5. That is the only diabetic patients are included in my study. The patients who are pre-diabetic are not included in a study because they are having a as they are pre-diabetic or having higher chances of diabetic neuropathy. So these are excluded. But
if they had a HbA1c of 13 or 14, did you exclude them or include them?
Sir, I include them in my study because as they are diabetic already, that is a score is more than 6.5. So I include them in my study.
Okay, so I'll come up with the answer why did I ask you this. So did you have any idea about what are the confounding variables in your dependent and independent variables?
Yes, sir. As my...
What are the confounding variables that are possible in this scenario, in this cross-section study?
Sir, confirming variables are like age is also a matter and gender also. That is, the females are having the more diabetic.
Dependent variable and a dependent variable you have got. But is there any variables that can influence these two relationships, the relationship between the independent and the dependent variable? If there is any other influence that can manipulate these two relationship, that is called as a confounding variable. Do you have anything like that? Can you just imagine about it? See, this research question is already answered. Do you agree or not? Because the duration of ailment naturally will be related to the disease progress. Any disease, that is true. Second thing is the diabetic control is a very important thing. As far as diabetes concerned, the glycemic control is very important. A patient who has been diabetic for 40 years may not have diabetic neuropathy if he is in regular glycemic control. But even if a patient is having 2 years of diabetes without any control, without any preventive measures to control the glycemic control, he may develop all the complications very immediately.
So,
how
sir,
did
that
you find a solution for this in your
sir, so this is also my confined variable, na, that glycemic control, the patients who are having a glycemic control are also not showing the symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy, but controversy also may happen in a diabetic neuropathy patient. That is, a patient who are having a glycemic control also shows the diabetic neuropathy symptoms in a short duration.
In a short duration. Okay. So what reason for that? Was that taken care in this study?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How?
Sir, that I have performed the Ahmednagar neuropathy screening instrument scale. That is accordingly by seeing the duration of the diabetes and the HbA1c level. So as the duration of the diabetes is more, then also patients are not showing the symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy in some cases. But
was controlled?
So that is giving the insulin providement or else. That is the medicine.
I was about to ask whether you had a check on whether your patient is taking oral hypoglycemic agents or insulin.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
So,
I have checked.
Most of them were taking insulin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Next question is, what is the clinical implication of this study?
Clinical implement of this study is that we are going to study about the symptoms of the neuropathy, that as previously described, the Michigan neuropathy screening instrument is not that much perfect, as it involves the two components, that is the patient component and the health professional component. So the patient component is like the patient is patient have to fill the form, that is in a question answer format, and health professional is going to perform some of the component.
One
Hello?
Minute, I think you got my question. You got my question wrong. My question was, what is the clinical implication out of this study? That is, what change this study is going to bring about in the assessment or the treatment of patients with diabetes in future? See, any research should have a clinical implication, right?
Yes,
this,
yes, sir.
We also have a clinical implication. So please tell me, what is the clinical implication?
Sir, as of very early, we can test the symptoms of the patients, that we can manage the treatment plan accordingly. That we are during the study or after the study, we come to know that the muscle strength is reduced or the reflexes are absent and the sensations and feet appearance. So accordingly, we can plan the treatment for the diabetes neuropathy only. That is, in the patients of the diabetes, they are also in a short duration, some patients showing the symptoms of the diabetic neuropathy. So if we come to know in earlier case that there may be a chances of the diabetic neuropathy, so we can manage the treatment after all. So this is the clinical implementation that is.
Good, good. It was a very good presentation, and arguably you supported your study.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
I have some queries too.
Yes, ma'am. Ahead,
hello. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
I have certain queries to, first of all, I'd like you to congratulate for selection of this topic. The topic sounds really good.
Thank you.
But there are some concerns, like, did you include both type 1 and type 2 diabetic patients in your study?
Yes, ma'am, I included type 1 and type 2, but most of the patients are of the type 2 diabetic diabetes. That is the, there is a 95% of chances of the patients are having the diabetes.
Have you got my question? Have you got my queries? Yes. Did you include both type 1 and type 2 diabetes mellitus patients?
Yes, ma'am, I included both the patients, but out of the my sample size, that is a 32, most of the patients are having a type 2 diabetes mellitus.
So don't you think that a patient with type 1 diabetes and another patient with type 2 diabetes whose age of onset is...
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Let me complete what I'm saying.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you think that a patient having type 1 diabetes who's having a juvenile onset?
Yes, ma'am. As compared to type 2 diabetes mellitus, type 1 patients consumes more time. That is, type 2 diabetic patients are consume less time to show the symptoms. As compared to type 1 diabetes mellitus patient. As I included both the type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes, but the most of the patients are of type 2 and they consume a less time to show the symptoms according to duration as compared to type 1.
So that is which kind of patients they take less time to show symptoms? Type 2?
Yes, ma'am.
Type 1?
No, ma'am. Type 1 patient shows the less symptoms and type 2 diabetes mellitus patient shows the more symptoms in a less duration.
Reason being?
Reason is that, ma'am, insulin is our cells of the body are not responding to the insulin well. So the type 2 diabetes patients are having the more symptoms and the nerve get damaged more.
So see, the age of onset of diabetes is one of the confounding variables, what sir was talking about earlier, like your glycemic control is a confounding variable, right? So
yes,
see, there is a limitation of a study you already mentioned, that is the sample size. And most of the patients you have taken, they are of young age, right? So it's difficult to generalize any of the findings that you have found. I would like you to carry on this study on a larger sample and you must calculate a sample size also for your study.
Yes, ma'am.
Right?
Actually, the sample size is up to the 80 to 90, but due to COVID-19, I was unable to go in a clinical setups and perform the scale on the patient. So
I've taken this cross-sectional study also, na? 80-90 yes. Is again less. You require much larger sample size because this is an undergraduate type of work. I really appreciate it. Okay. So in future, if you want to take it up as your postgraduate work or as your PhD, if you want to pursue it, this can be done on a larger sample size. And another thing, when we talk of a cross section, you need to include maximum number of variables that can affect your outcomes. Fine.
So
is lacking. The number of variables are less that you have.
Okay.
So I would like you to suggest you to go into more of the literature regarding this topic. Fine. And another thing I was concerned about was the tool that you have used. That is the Ahmednagar tool. So that tool has been, from where did you get that tool?
Ma'am, it is a screening instrument as a Michigan neuropathy screening instrument that we developed, that is in Ahmednagar, Ahmednagar neuropathy screening instrument was developed and the scale is performed.
No, that has been developed by your supervisor or something, or that's developed by your institute, that tool?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, fine. And one another thing is that whenever you present your slides, try to keep them the font for the content should be 24 and slide should not be that content heavy. Fine. So 6x6 is the rule generally. Six lines and six words in each line. Fine.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
That is easier for everyone to go through.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Fine. So that's from my side.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much, judges.
Thank you, ma'am.
For the wonderful insight and the questions that were put up. I would also appreciate UG01 for taking up such a important as well as a challenging subject at the UG level. I again request all the participants to please do not reveal your identity even during your papers, as in from where the data has been collected or from where you belong to which institute. I request you not to please reveal your identity at all. Going ahead, yes, I would also like to inform the judges that UG01 took 7 minutes and 15 seconds to complete the presentation. Going ahead with the second one, UG02, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am.
Once you open your slides, I will tell you to begin.
Hello.
Are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Is it visible? Hello?
Yes, it is visible.
And then my audio is fine?
Yes, we can hear you. You can begin now.
Can I start, ma'am?
Yes, you can start.
Good morning, everyone. The topic of my paper presentation is effects of exercise program and homeopathic remedy as an adjunct in treatment of knee osteoarthritis, a pilot study. So as you all know that knee osteoarthritis is a very commonly female than a male, and the symptoms which we see in osteoarthritis is pain during weight bearing, knee movement limitation, tenderness, rapidness, variable degrees of local inflammation. So normally pharmacological treatment for these pain and stiffness is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, that is NSAIDs. But the risk of NSAIDs include gastrointestinal bleeding, bleeding, renal failure, allergy, rashes, urinary retention, respiratory depression, and myocardial infarction. So multi-directional approach should be used to treat knee osteoarthritis. So this is the picture which you can see that how knee is affected in osteoarthritis. So in my study, instead of using NSAIDs or pharmacological treatment, I have used homeopathy, as it is known fact that homeopathy has very less side effects. So physiotherapy plus homeopathy is combined to do this study so as to avoid the side effects of the NSAIDs. So aim and objective. So aim of my study is to study the effect of exercise program and homeopathic remedy as an adjunct in the treatment of knee osteoarthritis. Objective is to study the effect of exercises with homeopathic medicine on pain, range of motion, insomnia, and disability. To study the effect of exercises on pain, range of motion, insomnia, and disability, and to compare the effect of the both groups. So these are my review of literature. And coming to material, it is a pilot study, and patients with knee osteoarthritis above 40 years of age were the target population. Sample population was osteoarthritic patients. Sampling method was quantitative sampling, and sample size was 10 subjects. So inclusion criteria are age of more than 40 years, grade 2 or more on radiographic severity according to Kelvin-Laurent scale, knee pain for more than 3 months, and patient prescribed with rust and calcium chlorica. These are the homeopathic medicine. Exclusion criteria, inflammatory knee disorder, history of knee trauma, or any previous knee injury. Coming to the procedure, after taking the permission from the ethical committee, patients were screened according to inclusion and exclusion criteria. Their informed consent was taken. 10 participants with knee osteoarthritis were identified according to Kelvin-Laurent scale, and each patient was screened for pain, range of motion, insomnia, activities of daily living using VAS scale for pain, knee range of motion using goniometer. Insomnia scales to the sleep cycle of the and MS scale was used to the functional activities of daily living. And patients were divided into two groups, experimental group and control group. Experimental group was of physiotherapy exercise program plus homeopathic remedy. Whereas second, that is control group, were only given physiotherapy exercises. Exercises included standing and stretching exercises, which are step leg rest, dynamic walks, hip abduction, sideline, 45 stretching and hamstring stretching. Every day, they have to follow these exercises. And after 10 days, patients were again called for the follow-up and assessment of the same was done. Now, outcome measures are visual analog scale, change of motion using goniometer.
Last 1 minute.
And so the results I concluded is that pain was reduced in both the groups. Ranges in both the groups were not effective. Then in insomnia scale, the insomnia was reduced in experimental group, and WOMAC scale activities of daily living were increased in significantly, statistically significant in experimental group. So this session, there are many articles which prove that only physiotherapy when given, it is effective in knee osteoarthritis, and only homeopathy when given, it is effective in knee osteoarthritis. So I have combined both to again see the effect on the knee osteoarthritis. So from this study, I concluded that we conclude that homeopathic medicine in addition to physiotherapy has better effect compared to only physiotherapy treatment. The multidirectional approach is more effective than osteoarthritis. So these are my references.
Thank you so much, UG02. Now the session is open for question and answers.
Congratulations for opening another avenue for physiotherapists from homeopathy point of view. I always had supported physiotherapy should work not only with allopathy doctors, they should work with the all other medical systems which are available. We can open up portals, and these medical professionals also will come to know about what is physiotherapy and what are the benefits and where they can utilize physiotherapy. So in that aspect, I'm so happy for this topic. But the way in which the study was done is not exactly the apt way it should have been done. For example, the conclusion says that physiotherapy along with homeopathy is more effective than physiotherapy alone. So had this study been done by a homeopathy doctor, this conclusion would have been fine. But what we should have concluded is rather than providing homeopathy alone, adding physiotherapy to homeopathy would benefit the patients much better. So that would be a proper propaganda for physiotherapy as a physiotherapy student, first of all. Second thing is there are a lot of confounding variables here. The quality of homeopathy treatment also matters. And very importantly, when you are treating a patient with both physiotherapy and homeopathy and another patient with only physiotherapy, without even doing a research, we can say that the patient who is being treated double is going to get benefit rather than being treated. So the patients were not treated similarly. The groups were not treated similarly. That is what I could assume. And the second thing is, in such studies, you should have seen the baseline homogeneity. So for undergraduate level, that is why I always say the experimental design is a very tough design to do. It is not that easy to control all the variables. Anyway, you have taken up this and you have done a pilot study, and with pilot study you would correct a lot of things. So my first question here is, what was the inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria? Can you just display once again? Yeah. All the participants, please do not close your screen unless the it is over, so we can discuss.
Yes, sir. Yes. So inclusion criteria included the patient is more than 40 years of age.
So
Yes, sir.
So, why did you confine yourself to above 40 and only to grade 2?
So because grade 1 patients, they only complain of pain. They don't have, like, daily activities are not that severely affected. So, with grade 2 and above, they have, like, pain for more than 3 months and their daily activities are affected. So, I took grade 1 plus grade.
Okay. And why more than 3 months, duration of more than 3 months? What is that star mark?
So, because according to the scale of Kelvin-Rollin scale, it is for coming to the level of grade, the patient has more than 3 months of pain. So,
okay. So, another thing is, even arthritis, you say OANE, it's a very broad classification. Osteoarthrosis by itself is inflammatory disease.
Yes, sir.
Of inflammatory as well as degenerative disease. That's why we started calling it osteoarthrosis of knee. So how can we exclude inflammatory knee patients?
So inflammatory in this, I have excluded which in patients which have like visible inflammation is seen on knee joint, because the exercises which I have given to those are exercises which patients should perform. So to because there is stretching protocol also and dynamic posture are there. So if patient has swelling, the patient was not able to do so. I excluded those.
So what I'm saying is, how did you rule out that? How did you rule out that? Osteoarthritis patient may also have a concomitant synovitis. How did you rule it out? A bursitis may also persist. How did you come to know that it was an inflammatory condition, and what were the criteria you had to rule out a patient as an inflammatory disease?
Sir, I had seen their X-rays were studied. Was studied before taking the patient. So based on that, I treated them.
Okay, all these set of exercises you have combined, are they already prescribed or you have combined them together? Okay, can you come to the result section?
Sorry, sir?
Can you come to the result section? Analysis, statistical analysis? Okay, what was the test that was used for the group analysis?
Paired and unpaired key tests were used.
Okay, you have a combination of both parametric as well as non-parametric values. Are you aware of? Okay, did you do a parametric test separately and a non-parametric test separately?
Yes. Sir, actually, I have combined for pain in experimental group and pain in control group, and the third was to compare the post results of control and experimental group. So there the time and concerned both which have to show
results of. I'm very sorry, you're not audible. Can you please?
UG02, you need to check your internet connection. You are not very clear and audible. Your voice is breaking.
Hello? Is it fine?
Yes. I would request the judges also to keep the times of question and answers according to what is being given 2 to 3 minutes.
If she's not audible, I think we can. I would like to stop my questions, and I would go with ma'am to complete the questions. I think if she can stop the screening.
Screen share. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
UG02, please stop sharing your screen.
Okay.
Dr. Supreet, ma'am.
We are running short of time, but one thing I would like to ask is, like in inclusion criteria, you have included the homeopathic treatment, right?
Yes.
So, yes, ma'am.
So,
this means that both the groups have been given homeopathic treatment.
No, ma'am.
Was it so?
No, ma'am. Only experimental group was given homeopathic
treatment. Then can we write it in inclusion criteria?
Yes, ma'am.
If you are writing something in inclusion criteria, this means that was common for both the groups.
Okay. Sorry.
Okay. Ma'am, we can move ahead.
Thank you so much, judges. Thank you so much, participant UG02. Now we go ahead with the third one. UG03, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Please give me a minute.
Start sharing your screen and you will begin once, only when I tell you to begin.
Yes, ma'am.
Judges, please note that UG02 took 5 minutes and 22 seconds to finish her presentation.
Ma'am, is my screen visible?
Not yet.
I have started it.
Yes, now it is visible.
Right, ma'am.
We cannot see the screen now. I request the participants to have a good internet connection, please. UG03, please share your screen.
I am trying, ma'am. Okay. Is it visible now, ma'am?
Yes, please open your presentation.
Right, ma'am.
Okay, you can begin now.
Right, ma'am. Do I need to put my video also on?
No, that's not needed.
That's not needed. Right, ma'am. Okay. So I will be beginning now. Good afternoon, everyone. Firstly, I would like to thank IAP for this opportunity to talk about my paper presentation. And I would like to thank the judges also and the other participants for sparing this time. Thank you so much. Now I would like to begin. The title of my paper presentation is Prevention of Respiratory Distress in Individuals with Parkinson's, a literature review. Okay, so now as we can say, we are now coming to face with the third wave of COVID-19, there is no denying that physiotherapy is going to play a big, big role, just like it has played in the first and the second wave. I am here to talk about prehabilitation. COVID has taught us how important prevention is. Just like we use masks and sanitizers, similarly, there is a big, big need for prehabilitation today. And this is all the more needed in vulnerable individuals like neurological patients, like Parkinson's. Okay, so now I would like to bring your attention to that as we address the fear of the third wave of COVID-19, my review is aimed at talking about the need of prehabilitation in Parkinson's. Now, Parkinson's patients in Parkinson's patients, we have some kind, we know that post-COVID infection, there is some kind of a residual lung damage and chest complications in patients. And in Parkinson's, there is already a reduced chest compliance because of reduced chest wall mobility, kyphotic posture. So there is a need for chest prehab in these patients. Okay. Moving on. A limited lung expansion and chest compliance contributes to less effective coughing, which is especially relevant for those with dysphagia. Parkinson's patients often have problems in swallowing, and as a result, they also have a reduced cough reflex. This could lead to occurrence of aspirational pneumonia, which can be deadly. Moving on, what sets PD apart from other neurological disorders is the fact that besides muscle weakness, which is present in both in other conditions as well as in PD, muscle control is also affected in Parkinson's disease. As we are aware that there is bradykinesia and rigidity in these patients, which is going to further reduce the chest wall compliance, which is already reduced because of the kyphotic posture. Added on that is the problems like bradykinesia and rigidity. So there is a need for some sort of intervention which will help in bringing back this muscle control. Okay. Moving on. The methods used were, I used the electronic database like Medline Pedro Research, and I used the keywords of Parkinson's disease, prehabilitation, physiotherapy, diaphragm, respiratory training. Moving on. Now I would like to bring your attention to the study which I have considered, respiratory prehabilitation strategies for Parkinson's disease. Patients can include inspiratory muscle training, expiratory muscle training, air stacking, breath stacking, intense incentive spirometry, along with postural education, which is a must, and respiratory muscle strengthening. We can also use techniques like ventilatory facilitation, diaphragmatic release, along with the conventional breathing that we do in patients, like diaphragmatic segmental thoracic expansion. These techniques should be added to the conventional techniques, right? Moving on.
This I request the participant, please don't move your slide. Just keep it the way it is.
Yes, ma'am. I will do that. Thank you. Okay. So, oh, sorry. So now these are the studies which I considered, and in these studies, this is the 2019 study, which again I would like to enlarge this so that you can see. This is the protocol which was followed.
Last right? 1 minute.
Okay. These were the studies, and these were the different protocols which were followed for inspiratory and expiratory muscle training. Okay. Now, what we concluded was that the expiratory muscle training significantly improves the chest compliance, and the inspiratory muscle training improved the phonatory aspects like the speech production, the swallowing, which were big problems for these patients. Now, what more can we do? Volume-oriented respiratory training interventions like breath stacking and air stacking along with deep breathing also help. And these should be considered, because with this, we can keep a track of how much improvement has come up in patients. Now coming up, this is one technique which I would like to bring your attention to, NPF, neurological facilitation of respiration. This includes 6 techniques like perioral pressure, intercostal stretch, thoracic vertebrae pressure, co-contraction of abdomen, manual pressure, and anterior stretch, in which we give a basal stretch. And these have been shown to increase the minute ventilation as well as the chest wall excursion at the middle segment. Okay, now along with this chest PNF, a pilot study of 2020 brought attention to chest PNF, how it provides proprioceptive input, which is very helpful in the patients of PD, as it works on the motor control. Okay. Small pictorial depiction. Now coming to the conclusion, I would like to just conclude saying that there is a very urgent need of prehabilitation protocol started for PD patients, particularly, we need it for everybody, but particularly for PD patients, because they already have so many problems and a reduced chest compliance. So COVID in these patients can be life-threatening. This can be delivered using telemeans, and virtual reality can be inculcated. Thank you so much.
Thank you, UG03. The session is open for question and answers.
Can you move to the title slide, please?
Yes, ma'am.
This is prevention of respiratory distress in individuals with Parkinson's.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So how many studies did you include for your review?
Ma'am, seven.
Seven. So was there any inclusion-exclusion criteria for inclusion of the studies? Any selection criteria for inclusion of studies?
No, ma'am. Because already there is very less studies available for prehab. I could only find literature about respiratory training in PD.
No, then that is why the seven studies which you have included, have they all focused on prehabilitation?
No, ma'am.
Then?
No, ma'am, I focused on including studies about respiratory training in Parkinson's disease. And the RCTs which I included, they two studies focused only on inspiratory muscle training, two focused only on expiratory muscle training, one included in expiratory muscle training plus.
What kind of review is it? Do you know there are different types of reviews? What type of different types of literature reviews are there? What type of review you have written?
Ma'am, this is a narrative.
This is a narrative. And you have included only RCTs in it?
No, ma'am. I have also included a pilot study.
Any other studies also?
Yes, ma'am. I also included a pilot study.
So there was no inclusion-exclusion criteria for your study? Whatever studies you got, you just included that, no?
Yes, ma'am. Whatever relevant thing I could find, I included. Because I wanted to talk about, I wanted that the rehab to include, because not one technique is going to work on one technique is not going to work on all the patients. Yes, some patients will be we can find some effect with one, and some we cannot find the effect. So that is why I wanted to include all the possible techniques that we can use.
Do you think there is some have you found in literature role of chest mobility exercises on Parkinson's disease, having said about the increase of thoracic kyphosis and stooped posture in Parkinson's patient? Do you think there is some role of chest mobility exercises? Have you included any study on chest mobility exercises?
Yes, ma'am.
So have you included any studies for chest mobility?
Yes, ma'am. The pilot study which I'm talking about is an Indian study from West Bengal of 2020, a very recent study, and that also focused on chest mobility, and that emphasized that
besides that are neurophysiological PNF, facilitation techniques, no? PNF techniques. Any other chest mobility exercises or any stretching exercises?
Yes, ma'am. Chest have PNF you, have also you includes stretching.
Any role of muscle energy technique there or not?
For muscle energy technique, I could not find. I mean, probably my search did not include that. But yes, stretching was very much included.
Did you follow a search strategy for your study? Did you follow a search strategy for your study?
I used the keywords, ma'am.
What keywords did you use?
Parkinson's disease, prehabilitation. Chest physiotherapy.
So I think there was a deficit over there in your search strategy, right?
Possibly, ma'am. Maybe yes, because
how many times? Let me finish. How many times have you gone through your PPT before presenting it?
Number of times, ma'am.
Number of times. Did you find any spelling mistakes in your first slide itself, which you are sharing? Do you find any spelling mistake over there?
Yes, ma'am. Respiratory.
Spelling of respiratory as such is wrong. similar is with the other slides. There are so many spelling mistakes. There are so many formatting mistakes. So whenever you present your papers in the future, right, content is one thing, but presentation also matters. You know, we have marks for presentation also. So right, your slides must be justified. Your spellings must be correct. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
You are whenever you start a sentence, we should start with a capital letter. You have written, you have started with a A, and that is in a small letter A. So these kind of these kind of things, they give a bad impression. Okay.
Right.
Rather than besides the fact that your content may be excellent, but if there are certain presentation errors or formatting errors, that give a bad impression. Fine. So please take care of these things in future.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. And the topic is good, and try to find some more studies in this direction. Fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. That's all from my side.
Thank you so much, Supreet madam. Sir, do we have some questions?
Yeah. First of all, congratulations for this topic and selecting this study methodology, review of literature or literature review, scoping review. All these things are intervention-based study. This is a very good attempt. But having said that, the way in which you have done, as madam said, you need more topics for a review, a literature review. You need a lot of topics, a lot of articles. You have confined yourself with this word pre-rehabilitation. This pre-rehabilitation is a very recently formed word. When we wanted to expand our borders, we have invented new names like this. So this long COVID, pre-rehab, all these things are recent words. So because of that, your search might have not fetched you more studies. And that is one thing. Another thing is a review, a literature review is not a systematic way of doing research. And so you don't need duration for the search or any particular type of research to be included. And there is no need for a inclusion criteria first of all. But you need a proper keywords. Proper keywords you need not mention in the search strategy also. But for you to search, you need proper keywords. During one particular period of time, these terminologies would have been missing. So you should have gone with mesh terminology. I think you would be familiar with mesh terminology. You would have gone with that. Then this would have sounded good. And as madam said, you have to be very prepared when you're coming for a presentation, and that too at this level. You should be very cautious, and you should utilize your time as well as the presentation should be very, very accurate, and should not have spelling mistakes and all. Otherwise, good attempt. Thank you.
I would like to add one thing. The techniques which I'm talking about, like NPF, I have attempted NPF in a patient with cerebral palsy, and I have seen increase in the chest wall excursion. So if this is included in other neurologically compromised patients like PD, like I'm talking about, it can be very much effective. I mean, just like ma'am was asking that about the technique. So I'm telling that why I'm talking about particularly NPF and chest PNF is because I have seen the effect in cerebral palsy. So if this can come in cerebral palsy patient, it can come in PD also.
Thank you so much, UG03. And I'm sure that the suggestions that both the judges have given is, they are very important ones in any paper or poster presentations. I hope that all of us will take care about these suggestions. We go ahead with the last but not the least participant, that is UG04. Are you ready? You can put your video off. Please share your screen, UG04.
I'm visible. My screen is visible.
Your voice is very low. Can you please increase your volume?
Yeah. Ma'am, okay.
You will have to speak a little louder.
Okay, ma'am, yes.
Madam, is she audible, sir, madam?
No, ma'am, it is not audible. I think she can remove her headset and directly speak through the system.
Can you do that? 04?
Yes, ma'am. Is it audible now?
Now it's much better, but it can be even more audible.
If I remove it?
Yes, I think so.
Okay, ma'am. Sure. Just a second.
No, the volume is very low. Judges, please note that UG03 took 6 minutes and 7 seconds. Are you ready now? Here you 04. We cannot hear you. Are you connected with your laptop or your mobile?
Yes, ma'am, on PC.
Can you hear me? So now I think you can start.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Be a little louder.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone present here. Today, my topic is prevalence of fatigue in non-hospitalized COVID patients. Objectives we are going to see are the following. Introduction, COVID-19 is predicted to have a significant influence on the patient's physical, mental, and social health. Most of the people who are recovered from the COVID-19 are completely recovered in a few weeks, but much of the patients have the acute symptoms and recovery. However, the many patients face persistent symptoms, and the most of the common symptom is fatigue, which is affecting the patient's lifestyle much more. These people sometimes describe themselves as long haulers, and disc conditions have been called post-COVID-19 or long COVID-19. In early reports, the fatigue is listed to 44 to 69.6%, and the further studies have listed the 34 to 46%. In one of the few reports to assess the long-term consequences in Toronto, they have experience the diffuse myalgia, weakness, and depression in a year after the acute illness, and they could not return to the work. Fatigue may hinder the activities of daily living of a person, and it requires a specific treatment if it is present. So to check the patient's condition in certain activities, fatigue is measured using the Childer Fatigue Scale. This study aims at finding out the prevalence of fatigue in COVID patients who were non-hospitalized. Methodology, source of data was different societies of the city, sample size was 102. Study design is observational study. Study population, COVID-19 patients diagnosed with RT-PCR and who were non-hospitalized. Duration of study was 1.5 months and major tool was Childer Fatigue Scale. Methodology, the study was done by taking a consent from the participants, and they were asked to fill the Google form, and the form which contains the questions regarding their basic details and self-administered questions. The questions were regarding that patients were having tiredness, feeling drowsy or feeling weak even after COVID, and after how much time this problems were there to the patients. Inclusion criteria, patients who were non-hospitalized and the patients who were diagnosed having COVID-19 before 4 to 5 months. Exclusion criteria, who were having comorbidity or went under the recent surgery, who were mentally ill and who were not comfortable using this technology. Childer Fatigue Scale, it is a questionnaire to measure the severity of tiredness and fatiguing illness. This scale contained the 11 question items, which were divided into two components, physical fatigue and the mental fatigue. These were the questions which were included, 11 item questions. And this is the Childer Fatigue Scale, which for the interpretation, we have the four options. That was the less than usual, no more than usual, more than usual, and much more than usual. Scale scorings of the scale was decided by the two system. First was bimodal and the other was Likert scoring system. In the bimodal, the respondents have to answer the questions out of four, which indicates 0 or 1. And in the Likert system, the questions were from 0 to 3. The respondents, if the score is 3, then we'll count it. If the Likert score is
last 1 minute.
Yes, if the Likert score is more than 3, it is being counted as a score of 33. My results are, total 102 participants have filled the form, and the analysis was done by calculating the score of the scale, and only 17.64% had the complaint of fatiguing ranging from the score more than 4. Discussion. Previous studies were focused on the post ICU patients, and one of the study concluded that the screening should be done on all the patients who are suffering from COVID-19. This study was done to find out the long-term fatigue after the COVID-19. The result states that 17.64% reported fatigue, and they had the increased sleeping hours and feeling of tiredness. The possible reason of getting less prevalence in that population may be young, healthy adults and who are not having comorbidities. The level may be of physical and psychological, but it does not reach at much more higher because it doesn't reach the chronic fatigue syndrome. My conclusion is that only 17.64% reported fatigue, but the study needs long-term duration so that the number of participants can be included. The limitations in this presentation is that sample size was less and technology was required for the assessment. And these are my references. Thank you.
Thank you so much, UG04. Now the session is open for question and answers.
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
judges, please note that UG04 took 5 minutes 58 seconds to finish the paper.
Sorry, I can't hear you properly.
Can we move to the select criteria slide? That includes your inclusion exclusion criteria.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay. Do you think mentioning age of the participants is important in inclusion criteria?
Ma'am, I have included all the age groups who are suffering from COVID-19.
Then too, dear, we have a age limit, no? That should be mentioned.
Ma'am, there is no age limit in this.
There's no age limit.
No.
Okay. And what do you mean by patients who were having comorbidity? What are comorbidities?
Ma'am, like diabetes or respiratory disease or something, which are side by side, which is also present with COVID-19. The patients who are presenting the diabetes or respiratory problems or any other disease, they are excluded from this.
So the term
Hello? Hello.
Yes, Supreet madam, we cannot hear you properly. Can you go ahead with your question, please?
Yeah. So in this inclusion criteria, what was the patient's treatment which was undergone? Because if patients have taken antibiotics, particularly the antibiotics, heavy antibiotics, which are used during this intervention for COVID-19, would take a heavy toll on the patient's health. Was that included here? What was the medical treatment that was given?
No, sir, I have not included that.
You should have included that. Second important thing is whether the patient was, what grade of COVID-19 it was. In the RT-PCR test, you would know what is the viral load of the patient. Based upon the viral load only, you can say that the patient will have long-standing complications for the patient or not. So if you are including non-hospitalized patients in your data collection and data interpretation, you should have said that the viral load was this much and these patients had fatigue more compared to patients with less viral load. So that was missing. And otherwise, a mental fatigue, which is a very subjective issue, how did you conclude on that? Mental fatigue, what is your conclusion on that?
Sir, if they are really feeling low or weak or having any breathing problem or something like that, which is not related to physical, that they are having muscle pain or something like that, but they are mainly having focus on the feeling weak or a lack of energy.
Okay, but that is highly subjective. That is another thing. So where did you collect the samples from? Was it random or it was conveniently collected?
No, sir, it was random. And the strategy was I filled up the Google form from the, I forwarded them and they have the self-administered questions and they have to answer the questions.
That is not random, that is convenient. Am I right? See, if you have 200 patients with you, all the data of 200 patients with you, and you select randomly patients out of them, then that is random sampling. This is convenient sampling. You are putting it on the internet or any social media. People who are affected, they are replying you back. Am I right?
Yeah, got it.
So then that is not random sampling. Yeah. And second, you cannot use your this criteria of selection criteria when you are going all out, saying that people who are having COVID can fill this form if you are not hospitalized. That is what you, that message what you have displayed. Can you have that message here?
Sorry, sir, I didn't get you.
No, no. You circulated this thing in your social media, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what message you had while you were circulating this?
Yeah, I have given that it is the find out the result of the fatigue, the patients who were not hospitalized but was affected from COVID.
Okay. Did you include this criteria of selection in that?
Yes, sir.
So, who are eligible for answering this questionnaire? Did you just display all these things?
Yeah, I've displayed that questions and they have to select from the interpretation was done from the option of 4, that less than usual, no more than usual, much more than usual, that way.
Okay, then how did you apply the selection criteria? How patients will know what is meant by comorbidity?
Sir, I have not included of the comorbidity, but I have given them option that they have any certain disease, so they have to answer the in a short question that they are having any other problems, they are facing any other. So I have given that short answer.
Though it is a good effort from your side, you should have displayed all those things first. So that comes in very important methodology. How did you communicate to your sample? That is very, very important in such online surveys. Am I right? So that gives us a clear idea whether you have done properly and whether the target population, what you intended, you got or not. So that is very important. Otherwise, I'm so happy that all these UG students have presented topics which are highly feasible, except the toilet study. Other three topics are highly feasible and you did not waste your time on some pseudosciences like cupping, dry needling or some unwanted things. So I am happy for that.
Thank you, sir.
So, over to madam.
Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Supreet, madam, would like to ask something to the panel?
Yes, one thing more. You didn't mention the response rate as such. Like, for example, how many people did you approach? How many filled up the form, right? And how many people having comorbidities were excluded? When you're talking about that I have excluded the people having comorbidities, then there should be a count of people who have been excluded because of comorbidities, right?
And around 200 participants, I have sent this form and I've got the responses of 102 people.
So that must be mentioned when you are presenting the results, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And we should always include a table on demographic features as well. That includes your age, your gender and everything.
Okay, yeah.
So you can find out certain relations between your questions with your demographic variables as well. Right? Maybe end of year old. So these demographic variables add certain credibility to your results and interpretation. Fine. So these must be included. Then also you put a good effort at undergraduate level.
Thank you, ma'am.
Fine. That's all from my side.
Thank you, sir and madam. Here we come to the end of all the four paper presentations of the undergraduate sessions. On behalf of IAP and IAPWC, I take this opportunity to thank both the judges, Dr. Arunachalam sir and Dr. Supreet madam, for sparing their valuable time to chair and judge the session for today. I also appreciate the hard work of all the four participants for taking beautiful titles at the level of undergraduates. I like to thank Dr. Sanjeev Jha sir, Dr. Ruchi Vashne madam, Dr. Nehal Shah madam, the IAP technical team and the entire IAP
CEC team and Women's Health team to have had a wonderful session for the UG paper presentation and other sessions which have been held in past 1 week's time. Thank you so much. I request Dr. Nehal Madam to please say something.
Thank you very much, everyone, for this support and cooperation to our IAP Women's Health Foundation Day this conference. And this paper and poster presentations that are being held since last 2 days is an extension of that conference. We have got huge response, and we are as a natural research head national committee IAP, it is always my vision to promote good research, and so we as entire team, I guess we should be working towards it, and we are trying our best. So hope to see many such good researches from India and then getting published at an international level in future. Thank you very much, everyone, for your support. Thank you, IAP technical team, and thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I request the IAP team also to stop the session for today.